How about the false prophet?
That's right.
The false prophet strengthening the hands of sinners. The false prophet who supposedly knows Hebrew and Greek. Yet does not obey the Bible.
He wants to know why murder is wrong. Is murder wrong because God says so, or murder
we're
wrong
asking
because
him.
You're killing people?
We're asking him.
Why do you think it's wrong?
Why is murder wrong?
If there is no God. I wouldn't want somebody to kill me. I look at other people, and I don't want to kill them.
You're going to die anyway, though.
So, so
you just here.
Your whole setup is, I'm only here for the eternal gift of afterlife. Well, you call it a gift, I call it a curse. I would never want to live.
I was
going to
be
that's
a curse
terrible.
For you if you don't trust Jesus.
Even if it was.
I would agree. If you end
heaven,
up in a lake of fire that eternity would
even
be
in heaven, if I were a perfect Christian, I would hate to be in heaven.
Well, you haven't answered the question to any logical conclusion. If atheism is true and there is no God, why is murder wrong or why is stealing
position.
Wrong?
It's not a positive position. It's, you have a claim. God
I'm asking your claim.
Hold on, no. I'm not
saying my
claim
is immaterial.
My claim doesn't exist because I'm not making a claim. You made the claim. I said I don't believe you.
We asked you a question. Why murder is wrong if there is no God and atheism
is true? It's a bad question. It's a bad question.
Do you believe murder is wrong?
Yes.
Okay, then why? From an atheistic worldview, why is murder wrong?
Because I have empathy, actually have empathy, and do not believe that it's okay to kill other people because I'm an empathetic person.
So if someone has empathy, then it makes it wrong to kill them. What if I have no empathy towards other people, then by default, would it be okay to murder people?
No, it wouldn't.
So whether I have empathy for people or don't have empathy for people, murder is still wrong?
Yes.
Well, you said the reason it was wrong is because you have empathy for me.
Yes.
Why is it wrong for the person who doesn't care?
Because the person that you killed has empathy also.
How do you know that? What if they don't? What if there's two unempathetic people and one kills the other? Why is it wrong then? Why is it wrong then?
I agreed to have you kill me, then
what
that might be okay.
What difference does it make?
That might be okay if they say, okay, I'm going to commit suicide. It should be allowed to commit suicide.
That's your preference, but that's not...
But
that's
if
not
that person... No.
Is
if
it
that
absolutely
says,
wrong
yes.
to murder an innocent person?
There's no
person?
Absolutes. You're going to talk about absolutes.
There's
morality,
no absolutes?
No absolute morality.
That's an absolute statement to say that there are no absolutes.
Okay. Yes, it is.
Are there absolutes?
Are you going to get me into this circular argument about absolutes?
You're the one who's saying there's no absolutes, which is an absolute statement.
Except for that one.
How convenient.
It's obvious that
there's a lot of convenience.
It can be an absolute statement.
Let's go for an easier one than murder.
Okay.
Why is stealing wrong if there is no God and all I am? Let's go with the
because
starting
point.
Because
that person has personal property. There's property rights here. The person has personal property. You know, life, liberty, pursuit, happiness, all that stuff that we, as a secular government.
Who gave them a right to have personal property?
It's a human right. It's a basic human
says
right.
Who?
Humanity, as a whole.
As a whole? What? There are plenty of people who don't agree with that, so it's not
you don't have personal property? There's plenty of people that say you don't have personal property.
I believe in personal property. But what I'm saying is from an atheistic worldview, if I don't care, so again, is it wrong for me to steal?
You're talking about a claim. You say God says this is wrong.
I didn't mention God once. I'm not bringing God into this equation. I want you to be consistent, because I don't believe that as an atheist, this is why I want to know if you're real or you're fake. So far, you're fake.
I'm
because
fake.
Yes, you're fake. You're a fake. No, I'm saying
that would be the definition.
I'm saying you're a fake atheist because I believe you don't want to take it from beginning to end.
No.
The beginning of atheism.
Oh yeah,
most atheists I meet are phones.
There's
about 5%. About 5% of atheists are real.
Two positions.
You're not. You're fake. There's where you are. I call
it. I'm a theist. I believe in God. That's what you're saying.
Well, you're at minimum a fake atheist.
No. There's only two positions. You're telling me that I believe in God. That's what you just told me.
I believe you must because you believe that there is some type of decision maker over and above. First you said
no
first
decision
you said
it's
wrong. First you said but
humanity
all
as a whole.
All human no
we
no.
agreed. We came together as a
we
giant
did? I missed the meeting. When was that? When was that?
Every law across the world, every civilization across the world agrees that killing your own people is wrong.
I don't believe that. I don't believe that at all.
Even cannibalistic tribes that go around killing other people and eating them, they believe killing their own is wrong.
What? But you said the first reason why it's wrong to murder someone is because you're empathetic towards that person.
Yes.
So, but then you also said that
empathy exists in humanity.
If I'm unempathetic, then it's still wrong for me to murder someone. So which is it?
Because as a society, we came together and said, okay, it's wrong.
So then what you're saying is it's always wrong to murder innocent people.
Yes, always wrong to murder innocent people.
But I thought you said there were no absolutes, except the one that there are no absolutes. So now there are two exceptions.
I'll tell you this. Huh? If there is a greater good thing, whereas you go with...
What is good?
Hold on.
What if I develop a society of my own?
You're going to let me answer your fucking question. You're going to keep talking.
You're irrational.
Hold on.
I want you to be consistent.
Hold on.
You said all of humanity decided something when they did. Maybe majorities, but not all of humanity. Maybe majorities. So would you say that majority gets to determine what's right and wrong for society?
Matthew and Luke say a bunch of the same things.
Does majority get to determine what's right and wrong for a society?
Yes, actually it does.
Okay, then why are you guys here rallying against a national day of prayer when the majority actually says that a national day of prayer is a good thing? Now, I don't necessarily agree.
I agree with you.
I actually don't really care about it because I think every day
I have no problem with freedom of religion.
So
you can believe what you want.
So
you have a free marketplace of ideas. Your idea is bad.
So you said that majorities get to determine what is morality for a society.
Yes.
Okay, then if that's true, then no majority could ever be wrong. Because that's your arbitrary decision. What if I develop my own society on an island, and it's 9 guys and 1 woman, and as a majority, the 9 guys decide that it's moral to rape women? Does it then become moral to rape? You said that the majorities get to decide morality. Why did it now change on my little island?
Because... Just because the...
Well, all right. Take your time. Think it through. So you're coming to the conclusion that you're a phony.
But you keep saying it's real.
Why is it wrong on my little island? Why is rape wrong on my little island?
Because you're infringing on somebody else's personal rights.
But the majority said it was moral.
Until you start infringing on somebody's rights.
Oh, now there's another exception. Okay. Who's to say that woman had rights? What if we all decided she has no rights? On my little island. My little atheistic island.
Because you have rights. Therefore, another human being has rights.
Says who?
Stealing is wrong.
That's what humanity is.
See,
there's no absolute lawgiver. That's the problem you're having.
Okay, another non-absolute. Okay. Let's say, you are an atheist, I take it?
Yes.
Okay.
I do not believe that God exists. That's the only criteria for atheism. There's no other criteria.
What I'm saying is that you're starting, do you agree, or you believe in the Big Bang or something similar to that? Okay. So your starting point is, in the beginning, hydrogen and helium molecules shoot out into frictionless space, plus time and chance gives us everything we have. That's your starting point, give or take. Your ending point is, just like the other guy up there agreed, you die, you fade to black, you have no memory of the fun things you did, you have no regret of the things you could have done more of, you just fade to black into non-existence, and that's it. And eventually even your children or all the generations after you will eventually fade into black and be that same thing. So your beginning is nothingness, your ending is nothingness. So what I'm saying is, for you to give meaning to that little line that's between two points of nothingness makes no sense. You guys cherish reason and logic.
That doesn't matter. The end point and start point don't really matter. I exist now. And I know that other people exist.
Does your life have value?
Yes.
Why?
Because I would like to be a better person so that future generations will be better than me.
Better than what?
Than anything we've done in the past.
By whose definition are you using of better?
Well, if you look at the past, we had uncivilized societies that went around killing people at will. Now we still have that, but we have less of it.
See, what I'm saying is that you
I don't want a utopian society. That really won't never.
What I'm saying is, you have a starting point of hydrogen and helium and frictionless space plus time.
You have a god that created that as your starting point. You have a complex social being that created all that is your start point. That doesn't make any logical sense to the point where
what I'm saying is here's what I'm saying to all
too complex,
here's
complex.
What, and my name's Buddy. What's your name?
Jason.
Jason. Okay. And I appreciate that you came over and talked to us. Most people did. And like I said, Gene and I have gotten into great conversations. He invited me here. But what I'm saying is that I'm not. I don't say that atheists can't be good moral people. And we love coming to atheist events because it's the one place we can go to where we know people aren't going to steal our stuff or break our stuff or spit on us or whatever. Atheists are the funnest people to talk to. But what I'm saying is I want you to be consistent. Is that if your starting point of humanity is hydrogen and helium in frictionless space, and all you are, Jason, is a sack of chemicals. You're nothing more than hydrogen, oxygen, carbon, silicon, calcium, stuff like that. You're a bag of chemicals. Now, you can look at any one of the elements on a periodic table or any combination of elements on a periodic table, and no combination of elements on the periodic table will ever develop things like a moral code, a system of justice, a system of right and wrong, better or for worse. So if you want to be an atheist, this is why I have this sign. Because if you want to be an atheist, I say go for it. I say be a great atheist, but be a consistent atheist, understanding that you're nothing more than a sack of chemicals, and this concept of good and bad, right and wrong, moral and immoral, doesn't make any sense, has no logic whatsoever, if all you are is a sack of chemicals in motion. Why would...
So you're saying that secular societies cannot work without a moral code at all?
No, I'm saying they can.
They can,
but
they have.
No, but they have no justification for it.
They doesn't have matter no, if they have a justification for it.
If atheism is true, there's no basis on which for it to exist.
They developed it because they don't want to have other people be rampantly killed or raped or murdered, whatever you want.
Would you claim yourself to be an empiricist, meaning you believe in what you can see, touch, taste, smell? For the most part, I mean, what you can experience with your five senses
for the most
is
part,
what is
yes.
real. Okay. And like I said,
I do know that things that are out there that I have never seen, touched, tasted, whatever, that do, like Australia, never been there. I've seen pictures of it, I've never actually been there.
Right,
it exists.
Okay. But you believe that that is something you can see, touch, taste, and feel. And now you guys cherish reason and logic, but you can't see, touch, taste, feel, logic.
But your brain can create it.
You believe. You believe in things like I would imagine you believe in love and morality and justice and right and wrong, but you can't touch, taste, feel,
they exist
see them.
Because we're constructs of the human brain and collective human body.
But what I'm saying is all your brain is, Jason, and not to be insulting, from an atheistic worldview, if atheism is true, all your brain is a bunch of it's water and it's whatever chemicals make up your brain, and there's some metallic fluid and blood and things in there that are sending electrical impulses and endorphins, and that's all it is just chemicals doing things. Like I was talking to Gene, your brain, the activity inside your brain, and endorphins are released, and what you might call love or affection towards someone, it's just chemicals interacting with each other. And it's no different than shaking up a bottle of soda and opening it up, and it's just chemicals reacting. It's just carbon dioxide reacting. How are the chemicals
react a specific way when you have emotions?
How are the chemical reactions that are going on in your brain any different than the chemical reactions of, let's say, a soda or a chunk of solid sodium being put in water and it fizzing and firing up? What's the difference?
If you're a true on a very, very simplistic, like low center, however, there's really not that much of a difference. However, the way they interact is totally different. They cause different reactions. And when they cause different reactions, different things happen because cause effect. And when those things happen, you experience those emotions that are processed through your brain.
That
goes through all these different steps to get to a certain point. It's really... no. As a base level, before you, at a micro level, there's not really much difference. But when you look at the macro scale, when you look at how everything comes together as a whole, then it actually starts to make a lot more sense.
Is love real, or is love just nothing more than what you determine as a pleasurable experience of a chemical and electrochemical reaction inside of your brain, inside of the material that makes up your brain? Or is love real?
You're asking, is love real or is love real? I don't understand the question.
Is love more than electrochemical reaction going on inside of your brain?
On a base level, no. But when, like I said before, when you take it all as an aggregate and as a whole, there is different reactions that lead to different
that version.
Well, you just said no, that it's really no different than that there's no value. What is it that makes the electrochemical reaction going on in your brain that you deem as love any different than any other chemical reaction than hydrogen and oxygen coming together in an explosion and making water? How is the
outcome is different?
What is the outcome?
You feel love. That is the outcome. All the complex process that goes through that is totally different than hydrogen and helium fusing. That's a nuclear reaction.
So why is the chemical reaction of that creates water of less value or significance than the chemical reaction that you call love?
It's not. However, the complex process that actually all the different things going on at the same time and then the different stages.
Go ahead and get some of Jake's conversation on it.